Doug, and I'm going to bring up Ryan and Jess from the film as well. And we're going to chat a little bit. We're Who's first in the firing line?
This should be Jess.
There we go. Okay, round of applause before we get started. I'd like to start off with... is just the generic Q&A question of where did the idea come from and how did it get started in your brain?
Yeah, so it was a confluence of a bunch of different things. I want to give the long version of this because it's like 10 different things, but so when I was in high school, I worked at Hardee's, which was the Midwest version of Carl's Jr. And I'll never forget working, and it was like one of my first jobs, and I worked alongside Minot, North Dakota, where there's a big air base up there, and all these nuclear weapons and fighter pilots and stuff. And then I started learning that some of the guys who worked next to me were enlisted guys and officers, and this threw me off. It was very confusing because I just assume if you're in the military, you fly fighter jets and that's about it. I don't think you necessarily flip burgers next to idiots like me. So this kind of like started screwing my head a little bit that maybe not everybody in the military is a Medal of Honor winner. And I also love this old movie, I'm sorry, it's Camille. So I love this old movie called The Swimmer, this old Burt Lancaster movie called The Swimmer, which was a short written by John Cheever, and it's this wonderful story about, very similar in many ways, about a guy who just sees all these people and they really like him at the beginning, and at the end of the movie they all think he's a total shithead. And even though the guy really doesn't do much, and even though Ryan has one really shitty scene, for the most part, he's all right. And your opinions, I would hope, are formed through how other people treat him. And I find that fascinating. So I could probably tell three other little ones, but that's the meat of it.
Well, this might just be you elaborating on what I just asked, but this is an interesting film in terms of like, it's dealing with a guy in the military, but it's not dealing with what he's done. It's dealing with what he's coming home to, in a way. So, what was the impetus for that? What kind of inspired that? Did you just want to take a different approach with it, or?
I don't know. I'm not sure I understand your question. I'm sorry.
Well, going back before, let's say before the ending, it's dealing with someone, like most films that deal with somebody who's in the military or coming back from that, it deals with what they've dealt with more than it does with what they're dealing with.
Right.
And I'm just curious about what made you go that track.
Well, in many ways, he was in the military. I mean, he's in the military for two reasons. The first of which is I have this cousin and she married this fellow who won the Congressional Medal of Honor. This is amazing, right? So that evening after the ceremony, we're all talking and he tells this story about how. He was told leading up to like, hey, we're gonna give you this thing, just to let you know, everyone's gonna love you, and almost exactly what the old guy tells him in the first scene. Everyone's gonna wanna buy you a drink, be careful. And when he told me that story, I was like, oh, dude, that's it. I'd always loved The Swimmer. I always liked this idea of telling a story this way, and the idea of like, oh, you can get a drink the whole night, and the movie starts out and he's in a position of authority. You know, everyone sees a guy in uniform and, thank you for your service. And there's immediate respect without having to establish anything about what the human really is. And that was a big driver.
How much of the script is on screen and how much of it changed over the course of production as you were working through the scenes?
I would say, like, it's a... We added some scenes after principal photography. We added a couple things, but the things in principal photography, I think for the most part, are what's written. Although I'm certain that for their scenes, I don't want to say this, it's not bad. Took liberties. There was like when we had downtime, they were working on their scenes, and as a result, you know, they can deliver a lot better than I can write it. So so some of it was changed. I think just to more naturally do what you guys felt was more natural.
Yeah, I think so.
Yeah.
Does that seem about right?
But in such a little way, I feel like the filler words, you know, that the core of what was in the scenes was on the page. Yes, I feel like.
Yeah.
And it's exciting to see with the additional scenes.
Well, my next question is for you. You now have a history of playing here at this theater, at least. Thank you. You love alcohol. A little dubious at times. So, what was it about this character that kind of drew you to it?
It's funny. I never thought of him as a bad guy. And I didn't realize how drunk I was going to have to play, really.
Yeah.
I drank so much fucking near beer in this thing. It's unbelievable. Uh-huh. Just cases of that shit. It's terrible. I was completely sober the whole shoot. This is a challenge. And, I mean, while we were shooting. But
the one you pounded, was that a real one?
I think
that was one real beer.
Yeah. Yeah. I think I did that 3 times. That was brutal. You know, what drew me to it was to try to show some kind of humanity in that those people, because, I don't know, I'm a relativist. I don't believe there really are bad people. You know, I just think there's people doing their thing. And you know, they were all kids, and everybody's fucked up to some degree. So I was just trying to, you know, add some of that humanity to this. I felt like this was a little weirder to play, to be honest, than the other thing. But
yeah.
It was really interesting when we were shooting in Dubuque, because, I mean, there were a few people I feel like knew we were shooting, but we would be out at night when other people were just at the bars. And a few times I actually got really nervous for Ryan, because it was like art imitating life imitating art at times, and people would come up to him and like ask him questions thinking that he was actually, I feel like you even had somebody point out some of the patches on your stuff, so I feel like it was really interesting to experience that side of things from this type of character. Like in just real life,
we shot some pickups on graduation weekend, and the entire downtown of Dubuque was filled with thousands of people, and they were loaded. Mm-hmm. And we had the wrong patches, you know, patches from the Marine Corps, the Army, and the Air Force, all on there on purpose as part of the you know, the wardrobe design. And this man, people had been thanking me for my service from the second I put the uniform on. I would go to get gas on the way to set, they would thank me for my service. It was unbelievable. And at first I would correct them because I felt like an imposter, ironically. And then after a while I just stopped, because I was like, Jesus, I'm not going to go through this whole fucking thing. Each time, oh, you're shooting a movie? Holy shit. And then I have to go through the whole thing. Yeah, we're shooting this movie. It's about seeing Doug's from Dubuque, but I'm not. I'm from Los Angeles. What's that like? I'm like, oh, I can't do this. I got to play. I got to go. So I stopped correcting them like Chad. And, you know, people would be like, hey, just have that coffee, man. It's cool. At the A&W place that was open late. And I would take it, man. I was just turning that character on.
You really immersed yourself.
Yeah, totally deep into that. But I will say, on graduation weekend, this one man, and he was a very scary guy. He was much bigger than me, and he had a dyed blue goatee, and his hair was all fucked up, and he was wasted and sweaty, and he came out.
He chased us.
Yeah, chased us. He's like, hey, man. what the fuck? What is this shit on your arms? And he was like trying to rip them off my arms. And I was like, hey man, I'm an actor. That's a camera over there. That's a sound dude right here. You know, we're shooting a movie. And he was so drunk, like he got it for a second and then wanted to go back into it. And he kept saying, we have a real problem with this around here. And thankfully, Doug got him off my back.
Yeah, it was scary. It was, he was upset.
I actually have a question for you. Were you aware of how often that sort of thing happens? And especially in like small town, but in different areas where people will just go out in uniform specifically, like, were you aware of that before?
I mean, I had heard in the news, that, you know, it happened. But it's not something I really cared about. I didn't think it was very interesting. Although I'll tell you, we're having a screening in like 2.5 weeks in Dubuque where we shot, and so like I felt uncomfortable like going back to Dubuque and saying, okay, everyone pay to come see my movie. So instead of that, I found this veterans organization to say like, so you know, tickets will cost. We're just gonna pay them, so that way it's like a fundraiser, and I'm not trying to like hustle more money out of the people that have already helped me. Anyway, so in the process of like coordinating that, I'm talking to them and I'm saying like, well, you know, so here's my movie. So just so you know, like here's what happens at the end. You know, because I didn't want like them to be surprised and offended or something. And to my total surprise, I'm like terrified to say this to this woman. And she goes, oh, that's great. We have a huge problem with that here. And it's like this veteran service center where you can go like, you know, play pool or, you know, it's just a place for vets to go hang out. So I was stunned. It was like the opposite answer that I heard that I never would have expected.
Yeah.
Never. Mm-hmm. I had no idea this was like a real
relevance.
Genuine issue.
Yeah.
A lot of films that take place kind of over the course of one night, a lot of the traps they fall into are visual. I'm curious, like, how did you work with your DP in terms of like mixing it up and keeping it interesting as it went along to make sure it didn't get redundant or didn't get, you know, that kind of just blah feeling that some films get that this one managed to avoid?
Oh, well, I'm glad you think so. my strategy from the beginning was to basically have the camera drink every drink that he had. So towards the end, as the camera would get more drunk and the editing would get worse. And so I tried to have, you know, some of these, the things I could control in post reflect, and how the camera behaved, reflect his drunkenness. So obviously the camera's, you know, I reckon the end.
Yeah.
So that was the ins and outs of that effort then. But I did, so there's a ton of people in the movie, and going into it, I wasn't certain, you know, how great everyone would be. First of all, I want to say Jess and Ryan, I'm so thrilled that Jess can be here for a screening. We showed her a couple times. I think she was so great. Every time I see the movie, I like the performance more and more. It's so much better on the big screen. But I got lost. I'm sorry. What were we talking about?
The people.
Oh, right.
The people.
What about?
You're surprised how good they are.
So yeah. So it was not, you're
even
making a movie.
Was, even though it was like my shoulder and your dad floating
right.
around, or you know.
Oh man, so many people were in this movie 15 times. But I wasn't sure about the caliber of everybody. I knew that we were going to be getting a lot of local people from Dubuque, and we got a lot of great actors from Chicago. And so I wasn't sure about what the scale would be, so I shot a lot of it for coverage, and that was a very deliberate kind of just covering my ass just in case somebody was atrocious. and, you know, there was a couple, they're not in the movie.
Just a technical, what was your shooting schedule?
We shot for 16 days, isn't that right? We had like one half day off where we went and shot some stuff without audio, and then we did pickups and a couple of new scenes, you know, 6 months or a year after the fact. So, but our initial principal photography was at 16 days, I think.
Yeah, that's great. Anyone out there have any questions they want to toss up? In the back.
I just had one little thought. Like, as we were watching it, I never saw a cell phone, or at least I don't think I did. So is there like a period where you had in mind when it was like set? Like, is it modern?
That's a really good question. Yeah, I think you got me. And well, first of all, there is one cell phone. One of the girls has a cell phone in it, and she stares at it the whole time. No, it's fine. It's fine. You know, I didn't think of that much. I was you know, a big part of the effort was I was trying to recreate an atmosphere that reflected how I grew up in high school in a little town in North Dakota. And we didn't have cell phones then. So I guess, and also, like, I think what I wrote, maybe wrote this like 7 years ago.
Yeah.
So, you know, maybe the cell phone just wasn't that present at the time. I don't know. Your dad did great, though. I hope you did.
Yeah, we showed up and Dan was like, oh, he's here.
Any other questions out in the audience? Yeah, right there.
As you worked on this doc in the beginning, did you ever anticipate, the number one, that it would take you 7 years to get to this point? I mean, whenever we all have ideas and we're going to do something, and as it turns out, this is more difficult than we ever expected. What's your...
Yeah, well, in the spirit of that, I really have to thank Ryan, who's done a fantastic job since we finished the movie of getting it seen and making sure it... I mean, you know, when you shoot it, so I wrote it 7 years ago, maybe we shot it 4 years ago. You know, after principal photography, we edited it all together and there was a whole movie and, you know, we showed it to a bunch of people and tried to get into festivals and our first couple scenes were rough. There were, you know, at a previous Q&A, a guy asked me this and I regret not saying it. You know, one thing we talked about a lot, which in the first scenes that we got cut, is how being in uniform changed a lot. So back, you know, if you were a Vietnam vet like my father was, thank you, Father, you came back from war and you were kind of a shitty person for having a uniform on. And I wanted to try to address that that difference in that scene where we got cut. Anyway, the point is those scenes were really boring and slow despite being important. So that kind of extended the movie of, you know, the process. So we knew we were gonna, it's probably best to get rid of these slow, boring scenes that nobody likes.
And we hung on to them, though.
Yeah, they stuck around longer than they should have, maybe. I just cut it to the very, and it was still not good. So yeah, it was really hard. It was challenging, and to be screening the movie is nuts in a way. It was rough for me for a while, and I really have to thank Ryan for sticking with it and always being, you know, anytime. The idea of like going to your producer and going, oh, dude, you know, I think this is not great. Can we go reshoot this? I'm terrified to ask this. No one wants to go reshoot anything. But Ryan was extremely supportive and really behind every change we wanted to make and everything we wanted to do along the way. And that, I thank you a thousand times as I have before, but with an audience.
What would any of you say it was maybe your favorite scene or moment that didn't make it in?
I don't think I liked anything that didn't make it in. I regret that I couldn't say those things about, you know, something that was important to me.
Yeah.
I don't miss anything. But I'll say some out there, they asked me what my favorite scene is. I really like the pool scene. I love when they're playing pool. I think it's great performances, and it's hard to, I mean, there's so many great elements. I feel like every scene is so different, but I'm jazzed about the pool scene. I always like watching that one. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I think we should answer what our favorite scenes are.
Our favorite scene.
It doesn't have to go on your end of it.
My favorite scene is actually early on when you're talking to the Bills and Felix. That's my favorite scene. Just the energy, even when you guys were filming, the energy of all of the guys, it was so wonderfully cast. You really just all felt like you had grown up and known each other, and that was right at the start, or at least I feel like for me it was one of the early days.
Mm-hmm.
So that's my favorite scene.
Mm-hmm.
I am a little sad that Jeremy Clark's butt is in it.
Jeremy Clark butt scene, not my favorite. I don't know. I like that bar scene too. That one with the pool, I thought it was good. It was a lot of fun. I felt like I was doing scenes with Robin Williams the whole time. It's weird.
Yeah, he's great. So I gotta say, so in the spirit of the chemistry, I think I don't know, did the Phils know each other before that?
Yeah.
They did, okay. But Jonathan, you didn't.
I didn't know.
So, but we were all staying at my grandmother's house. My grandmother's house basically was like a barracks where upwards of 10 people, I don't know, tons of people were sleeping in this house. And so there are inflatable mattresses all over the basement. And I think, you know, between that and, you know, hanging out and drinking and, you know, just, we, you know, we all had meals together and pizzas. And I think that went for something. I mean, in this funny way, I feel like the people who are in scenes together are kind of still friends. I don't know. I feel like, you know, we all became buddies.
Bonding process, for sure.
You have the questions out there?
So my favorite scene was the one in front of the stairs. And I was wondering, like, how did you, was that, were kind of the scenes there sort of revolving around finding the stairs? How do you find stuff like that? Like, was that in the bar, just sort of like plan your stuff in the bar and go, oh, let's film it over here? Or was that like, you know, in a movie theater or something?
No, it was totally lucky. I think we were supposed to shoot that scene someplace else, and I honestly, the day of or day before, like 8 o'clock that morning, we were supposed to shoot at 11 that night. They totally bailed on us. They're like, "Oh, we're not gonna." I think that was part of the confusion. Like I was like, "We'll be there at midnight on the 3rd." Well, to him, that was midnight on the 4th, and so everything got crazy. And so another place that we were shooting the scenes with Melinda, they also own this other bar, so they let us use this other place, and the stairs are just there, and we all just died. I mean, it was
like the basement.
Yeah, yeah. It's like, this, like
no one uses this.
Yeah, it's like
basement.
this ancillary kind of downtown, you know, downstairs area that they'll use if they need a party or something like that, which made it very convenient for us. But they were very cooperative and cool, and we shot the scene. First of all, this is another scene that they totally. I'm a director, but. I think that scene in particular, they worked out very much between themselves. I know they did a lot of rehearsals about that, and you know, I would in Grandma's house, I'm walking around, and they're working on the scene, and you know, all these other things are happening. Also, I have to say that I'm really proud of that scene. We shot it. We also shot it for coverage, so we had a tight, and then a wide, and in cutting it, it was you know, they did the whole. I mean, there's no cuts. They're just in front of the stairs the whole time.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's testament to their great performance, and I think it also adds to the great tension that builds
mm-hmm.
up by just holding on to it. And I remember a BR, our everything, who was on set, you know, when I got done, he's like, oh man, that was intense. And you know, we couldn't decide, like, do we emotionally all have that in us to do that again? Because,
yeah.
You know, we all love Jess, and Ryan's an asshole, and, you know, he's like assaulting her, and we're all just standing there, like, we're just supposed to just take this? And I think the same goes for Ryan, too. I'm sorry, I'm yapping so much. But,
yeah.
You know, everyone's really mean to Ryan at the end. And I think that was really hard for him in a way. Like, there's some scenes that I felt really bad because people are just, like, shitting on him for, like, 5 minutes straight, and he's just got to take it.
I have a funny story about that. Antonio in the bar where we play pool, I met him that morning or that evening, and we talked for about 5 minutes, and he was like, oh, this fucking sucks, just out of nowhere. And I said, what? And he said, you're cool.
Yeah.
This sucks. It's going to be really hard to be mean to you now. So we have to stop talking. You go do something else, and I'm going to get pissed again and work on my prep. And I went, cool, man. So I went and ran around the block a bunch of times, which was weird. But
it's very meth-like.
Super method.
So a lot of these actors came from Chicago. So in many cases, we had to drive to Chicago and pick them up. You think it was really like, oh, this is convenient. It's just 3 hours away. But it's 3 hours there and 3 hours back. So, you know, sitting in the car with Antonio, who I didn't really know for beans. We did, most everyone was cast on a Skype audition because I'm not going to fly out to Chicago. So I did Skype on everyone, Jonathan. And so I didn't really know Antonio. Then, you know, a 3-hour car ride is all about, you know, the Eastern European playwrights that he reads, and it's just like, he's like, whoa, what's my motivation? I'm like, well, it's, you know, used to be your sister, you know, he's me and your sister. And he wanted way more than that, and I had nothing. And it was a very long drive, because I realized I had to meet his expectations, which were really high. But he was great. Great performance.
I'm curious, was there ever, throughout the course of production or post-production, was there ever any influence or any thoughts about having a different ending? Or was that always...
Yeah, so through our trials and tribulations of submitting to, you know, giant festivals and not getting our way, you know, I would say to Doug, you know, we have a great drama here, Doug, and if this doesn't work out, we can just go shoot some more pickups and basically just Chad kills his fucking parents, or shoots his dad in their room. I mean, I was even pitching that at the last minute. I'm like,
for
we
real.
Still
it was a real
change that audio while the camera's holding on that open door that he just kills his dad. I don't know, man. Let's try another round of festivals. And I'm like, yeah, you're right. Yeah. I was like, these horror movies, they're really silly.
Oh, man.
Oh, my God. Sorry. Sorry.
I have a question, Doug. You started writing this a long time ago. How did you feel about Chad when you were actually writing it? I mean, obviously you're writing the script to sort of dress down this guy by the end of it. But like, you know, Ryan comes in and makes it very sympathetic, you know, as much as he's an asshole through the latter third of the movie. I mean, did your opinions of this character change through the process of shooting it or writing it, or are they the same, or?
That's a really good question. Yeah, a little bit, because of some of those conversations about, like, what can we do at the end, like, how can we change this? It got me thinking about different kinds of things and different places it could go. Do you have any 2 cents about this?
Yeah, I mean, I think we wanted him to be far more of a villain when we first started out.
Mm-hmm.
And then I feel like through the journey we kind of, he humanized more and more, right?
Yeah, there was, yeah. You know, at first, I don't know if there was as much of an effort to make him look as great as he was at the beginning. Like, at first, I'm not sure, you know, I was trying to go for total G.I. Joe, you know, everyone's favorite guy. But that changed, you know, once you start seeing where it had to go, then you got to prop up this side, you know, trying to,
mm-hmm.
you know, a big goal was to try to actually do 3 things. This is your answer here. So, initially I wanted to do 2 things. I wanted to say, like, he's a great guy and then he's an asshole. But through the course of it, I realized that it's a tough end on asshole. And if we could make him sympathetic at the end, that would be a total, you know, another turn that he could make. And so my goal was, nice guy, asshole, oh, you know, that poor guy. And I'd like to think, I think that's kind of there. I think I'm very actually proud of that, because it feels like it's a natural curve of 3 different emotions for the same character, and I think that's cool. And that third emotion of pity, I don't think came along so much later.
Got time for a couple more. Anybody in the audience?
And also Jonathan's here. I feel like he should say something.
Well, come on up, Jonathan.
What's
that?
Do you
get a quick question for
me,
please?
Oh, sweet, cool, thank you.
Does anyone have a question for Jonathan?
I don't really have one for Jonathan. It was whole, maybe
that's
the group
cool.
as a whole. Again, of the whole process, again, as I questioned before, was over a 7-year period. What do you consider the most difficult part about having, from the concept of when you were growing up in Minot to this point of getting this job done, which you started as a concept way back then and said, how do I get this done? Staying committed to that, to follow it all the way through, to putting together a cast, a great group of people, and then having created a successful movie out of the whole thing, what do you consider the most difficult part of doing all that?
Well, thanks for the success line. and I have to give credit to my wife, who's not here, two brothers in the back, Paul and James. Melinda did a lot of the casting work and just did a fantastic job, I think. We've got a lot of great people in the right spots. And I think that's the answer to the question. I think the heart, like if I'm working on something or shooting something that day, the most, I'm filled with anxiety because I don't want to waste people's time. And I think that, you know, here's 10 people here waiting for my answers. Mm-hmm. That's the hardest part, coordinating people and giving respect to their time and not screwing over their time. That's what gives me anxiety, just not wasting people's time.
What attracted you to the project?
I had a couple reasons. A, I've grown up with a lot of friends that were in the military and in a military family, and one of the weird things that I always hear from them is when the experience when they get back is they don't feel like heroes or anything in particular. In a lot of ways, I've known a lot of people that have a lot of shame afterwards for things that happened or things they witnessed. And then they go out to wherever and everyone wants to buy them drinks and call them a hero and all this stuff. And it puts them in a predicament because they can't say, no, screw off, I'm not a hero. They have to accept it and move on. And it puts a strange pressure on them. And I don't see that in film. I don't see you discussing that aspect that I thought was really fascinating. Like the key scene to me is when you leave the bowling alley and the guy goes, I didn't like that fucking guy in high school.
Oh, it's my favorite part of the whole
thing. Right.
Yeah.
I love
of the movie.
That.
Thank you.
Like, there's I respect the hell out of everyone who served for this country, but there are some assholes that have served for this country too, and I've known some of them, and I appreciate their service, but they were still a dick, and it's a weird conflict that you put yourself in, and that was very drawing to me. And for Felix, I also love playing really asshole characters. I find them fascinating, and Felix is, he's a fascinating guy. But I think with like your character, my character, they weren't the best people ever.
No.
But it was a compensation. Like your character had a really rough upbringing. Your dad was brutal. I've known a lot of guys that act just like Felix, who put on a strong air in order to compensate for something lacking. And that's what I find intriguing about playing those characters.
Yeah. Yeah.
Great.
Cool.
Yeah. One other thing I will say about the military service stuff, which I don't know, my dad served in the military, but he didn't serve here, and because of where he served, they were not considered heroes. If anything, they were kind of on the wrong side of history, and that kind of gave me a different feeling about it, to where I don't know, I was okay with digging into the dark about that, you know. I didn't get the whole hero thing at all. And Doug was like, no, he's super heroic here. I'm like, okay. So it was different for me. I guess I approach it from a totally different angle because of that. Yeah.
Camille, are you attracted?
Yeah.
Jess?
What's the base question? what attracted me to the project?
Yes.
Oh, great. So I knew Jeremy Clark. We had done the acting program together at Purdue, and he had just mentioned to me, hey, I know these guys, I worked on another project, blah blah blah, there's this thing, I think you'd be great for it, do you want to Skype? And I was like, oh yeah, this sounds amazing. And honestly, what drew me to the project was my Skype audition with you. I think Leonard was in the background, and I was just like, I want to do this. Like, I want to do this. This is one of those projects where everyone is on board, you know, doing, filling in however you can. It had such a family sort of feel to it, even though we had like just met each other. And those are the types of projects that I absolutely love. Because if I'm not on camera, if there's something I can do behind camera, I'm happy to do it. And you guys were definitely the type of group to do that with. So that's really what drew me to it.
My final question is for you three, and it is, essentially, what do you think your character, where do you think your characters are now? Do you think that they have learned anything, or do you think that they're still just trucking along down the same road?
I'll go for it.
I'm short. I've been Camille in a way. If I met my college self now, I would punch myself in the face. Like, so naive and just idealistic. And while those are wonderful characteristics in a person, you're just like, oh, sweetie. Like, so I feel like this was her wake-up call. And I think she did a lot of growing up. And then she's probably learned a lesson or two since then. But probably not moved to the city.
I think Chad is much like a lot of the guys who were in my hometown that I went to high school with, who still work at the lumber company and are weekend warriors, and this is going to sound awful, but live quiet lives of like painful desperation. And I see them whenever I go home and they're like, oh, you know, and I'm like, fuck, man. So I think Chad is probably still working at that storage place outside of town, and he probably got a DUI. Yeah, couple. Yeah, and his mom does not talk to him or do his laundry.
I don't think Felix has learned anything. Parts of Felix I really enjoy. I imagine he knocked a girl up and then he locked it down because he's not a total asshole. You get it. I imagine he has a couple more in a dead-end job, but he still goes to the bar and tries to pick up college girls because it's the only thing that makes him feel interesting.
Yeah. I think that's a good ending note. Let's give it up for the cast. Woo! Thank you guys for participating in the Q&A.
Appreciate it. Thank you guys for
everybody
coming.
Everybody get home safe.
We are going down the street to Stellavara. There's a wine pizza bar down the street. Sunset.
That's good.
Yep. Thank you.
And then they looked at me, they're like, you're such an asshole. Like, I know, he always plays this game.